Hello Malty, mythical mega mflona. And thank you to Judge Holden for providing a malt mention. Just put a wee line through the malt mention, now it's been mentioned. For Ralfy Review 886 Extras. I've just done a review of this. Jim Beam, black, triple aged, 6 years old. Bourbon, generic, available, not too expensive. If you're getting into your bourbon, it's a good place to start. It's one of the first stepping stones on your journey. A journey of discovery of smell and taste. Very rewarding senses when we use them properly, but we should never be in any hurry to develop them too fast. We take our time. Just as starting a distillery and setting up a distillery is something you should take your time about. Now, I got a message from Mark Petrovic. Thank you, Mark. It's actually been quite a while ago I've got this, but I'm getting around to answering the question that Mark's been asking me. And I'm going to read out his message to you and then provide you and Mark with a response. Ralph, Happy New Year. Yeah, it was back in January. Say, would you consider making a video where you discuss, one, how to start a distillery, a new distillery, if it takes 10 years to begin selling product? So what do you do in the meantime to put bread on the table? And two, how do distilleries maintain skilled staff and continuity across the many years required to mature their whiskey? Many thanks, ever curious, Mark. From Petaluma, California, USA. Right. Here's my response, Mark, in two parts. Addressing your first question. How to start a new distillery if it takes 10 years to mature your product before you can really sell it. The first thing I would say when you're starting a distillery is learn very, very quickly to look after your finances, and that means controlling your finances. Importantly, when you are starting a distillery and it's a very small operation and you're in charge, you're the boss, it's your distillery, let me tell you that if you don't control the finances, if somebody else does, it ain't your distillery. Don't kid yourself. Doesn't matter about the contract. It really doesn't. You want to have full financial control and ownership of the operation. That means be careful where you site your distillery. It doesn't have to be right in the middle of a conurbation where you can get lots of footfall from locals and tourists. Because if you happen to rent your premises and the people renting to you see your distillery establishing and becoming profitable, they will up your rent, knowing it's a major hassle for you to up sticks, stills, casks and everything else and move elsewhere. Keep it small. Do your homework. Learn how to distill. If it means going to another distillery and volunteering to do a wee free shift in exchange for a bottle, do it. Nothing will teach you more about distilling than rolling your sleeves up, getting on site and actually doing it and listening to the headaches and the heartaches and the hassle that those who own that other distillery are going through. You need to take a reality check. The sooner you do so, the better. Right, moving on. So you found a location. It's outside of the town, but it's not too far out. It's a couple of hours drive, right? Which means for people going on a day trip, it's not too far of a joint. People will come out to visit your restaurant stroke business. Stroke distillery, stroke shop, stroke gas station, stroke craft fair venue, stroke art gallery. When you start your distillery, you've got to look at not just the distilling opportunities of your little business, but every other opportunity that you can bring on board your distillery that are going to attract footfall, visitors. When people get there, when they hear the sound of their barrels being rolled, when they see the shiny copper stills hissing and bubbling away, they're going to be curious. It doesn't matter whether they know about whiskey or don't know about whiskey. And they're going to say to themselves, my goodness, you've got a great big, it's almost like a barn here, and you've got this tiny little still in the corner with a few wee receptive tanks, you know, and the feeder tank and your wash back and all the stuff. And you've got all that space, and they're going to say, what are you going to do with the rest of your space? Is this going to be your warehouse? No, it's not. It's room to expand that you already have, already own, and it's all ready to go. You're going to buy stills. Are you going to buy fancy eye stills, Holstein stills, patent stills, Faraday stills? My goodness, you're spoiled for choice. Let me give you some advice. If you're producing a liquor that's all about smell and all about taste and the identity that goes with that, you keep your stills very, very simple. You go into eBay and you order yourself up a cheap as chips Portuguese alembic still, because I'm telling you right now, that does the business. It's just a fancy copper kettle. That's all you need. Once you start getting into fancy rectifying and cutting and splitting, all that activity is refining your product and gradually but steadily turning it from whiskey into vodka. And if you don't do it in the stills, you're going to do it in the casks, because gentle, soft whiskey going into active casks, the casks are going to cook your spirit. What do I mean by cook? It's a professional term. It means that you put your spirit into the cask, nice fresh cask, ex-bourbon cask, virgin American oak cask, plenty of casks to choose from, perhaps some imported Marsala, Madeira, port, red wine, white wine, rosé wine, all the way from wherever. And you look at, you smell that cask, oh, it smells lovely. It's going to make my whiskey lovely because the cask smells lovely. And then you come back 6 to 8 months later and you discover that particularly with the heat and the general activity and bustle and vibrations around your warehouse, because it's just a little warehouse, you're constantly in and out, the slumbering casks are not getting much sleep, put it that way. And what you will find is that very quickly the cask takes control of the spirit, and the spirit loses its identity. And when it loses its identity, it's losing your distillery's identity with it. So if you've got soft, gentle, subtle, light spirit, basically you want casks that the easiest thing to do is fill them up with water and soak them for 3 or 4 days. And then empty out. Wash out your cask before you put anything in. If they're virgin oak casks, make sure you get them toasted with a char finish, but not a lot of char. If not, you've got a big, heavy, dense mixed mash bill product. If you're doing malted barley spirit, it's light, it's delicate, it's subtle. It's not really going to like fresh casks. You've got to be careful with this, otherwise the casks cook the liquor. Your ingoings and outgoings don't expand too fast. Get yourself in social media. Say hello to people. Don't tub thump your message. Don't shout at people. Put the systems in place on your social media where you find your local whiskey club and you just go along and say hello. Would you like us to come down with some of our new make spirit? to give you a wee taste of what we're doing, and we'll tell you about it. It's free of charge. What whiskey club's going to knock that one back? So down you go. Say hello. Few weeks later, you're getting good feedback from them. I tell you what, folks, we'll pay for the bus. We'll have you out as guests. It's a local whiskey club. What do you find in local whiskey clubs? People who are discerning about what they drink and are spending a lot more money in what they drink, and they're opinion formers. They talk about what they drink. They introduce friends to what they drink. And they want the bragging rights of your new distillery that's just set up, with its restaurant and its shop and its little gallery of craftware, all locally sourced. And you're going to have a mission statement. And let me tell you what you're going to do with your mission statement. You're going to print it off in a big piece of really tough paper. You're going to put it in a frame, and you're going to hang it on the wall in your entrance. And you're going to tell people when they come in, with all the gilt edge around it, nice and fancy, this is our mission statement. This is the reason our distillery exists. This is why we do things the way we do it. Keep it short. Keep it sweet. Call it your declaration. Make it public. People will want photographs beside it. They will then post the photographs on social media. It works. Do not bottle your product until it's ready. You may have people want to buy casks from you. Check in their reputation. If they're already established as independent bottlers with a good reputation, you can sell to them knowing that their good reputation will look after your good reputation. But if someone comes along and starts to haggle a discount to buy 50 casks of your whiskey, no, no, because you're dealing with a speculator and probably an arsehole who wants to muscle in on your growing reputation as a speculative investment. Next, you'll have the investors coming in. We love what you do. In fact, we think the sun shines out your ass. We want to put money into your company. Can we take you out for dinner? We'll pay, and we'll ply you with drink and more drink, and we'll remain sober while you get pished, and then we'll show you this wonderful contract which you don't quite read before you sign. Don't entertain it. If you need additional investment, you reach out into your local community for someone that's long-term in that community, has a solid reputation, and you invite them to be an angel investor. Only allow investors who are going to invest in your business properly, to your standards, and are not going to sell your business right over the top of your heads with protracted, outrageous lawsuits where the only winners are the lawyers. What do you sell before your product's ready? You sell other products. What else can you still make? Sure, get yourself a little Holstein still. Something second-hand, not too extravagant. Create some gin, create some vodka, not very much, slightly higher strength. Pretty labels. And don't forget your gift bottlings for people that don't want a full bottle. Half-size bottles, little miniatures. It costs you a bit to put them on the shelf, but it fills the shelf and people buys them. People buy them. Look at featuring another local alcohol producer, perhaps a local winery, a local brewery. Do a little mutual partnership with them. We'll stock some of your product in our shop. How about that? Give us a mate's rate. Let's go for it. You're building up good rapport with your competitors. Always help your business by making sure your competitors are friends. Part two of the question. I mean, it's covering a lot of ground here, so I'm only giving you a resume. Always do your tax return. I'm just telling you right now. Always comply with the bureaucratic regulations. Fill in your paperwork. Deal with your bureaucracy politely, with respect, and put your taxes in on time. Keep your nose clean. If you get a criminal record for any reason, you could lose your license to distill. Know that. Two, how do distilleries maintain skilled staff? Simple. Employ the right people to start with. You're investing in their skills and allow them to invest in your business. Create staff shares. The longer you work, the more you're worth to the business, the more staff shares you get. 20% of your business could be down to staff shares, where you've got shares yourself, so you control it, but you motivate your staff by making them feel they belong, because as well as their work investment, time investment, skills investment, they've also got a financial investment in the success of your business. When you train your staff, make sure you've got someone that's going to stay with you after they have been qualified and will not be poached to someone else for more money, allegedly. This happens with coopers. Coopers, rare as hen's teeth, because too many get laid off too quickly in the Scotch whisky industry. And now there's a shortage. They don't say it, but coopers, more so in Ireland, more so in Ireland. If you've got casks in a warehouse, you need someone with coopering skills. You need an employee that you send off to work in a cooperage to learn skills on a week-long release course with a mutual beneficial tie-up with that cooperage who's going to supply you casks. You're building a relationship with them and you make sure that when they've got the skills, they want to stay with you. Sometimes staff go. It's understandable. This is why you've got to be careful who you choose in the first place. And what I'm talking about is don't automatically choose family. They can be the worst employees out because of their entitlement and lack of suitability. Employ people that are workers and not shirkers. You need to use your instinct to know these people when you meet them. Anything else I want to add? And continuity across the many years required to mature whiskey. So this is ties in another little act added extra here. When you're keeping staff, one of the best ways to do it is to not stagnate your business, but to gradually grow and diversify your business. So, for example, if you're a small distillery, but you don't have a lot of room to expand, you want to create your own independent bottling or importation company. Very small, keep it small, specializing in spirits, wines, beverages from elsewhere that are similar to yours and that your customers will identify as much as they identify your product. So you can either just expand in size, particularly if you've got the space to do so, and you do it organically, which means slowly, don't force feed it, don't push it, don't stress yourself out. You're going to learn a lot along the way, so don't plan too much, too soon, too far ahead. Be always prepared to go with the flow and move with whichever the way the wind blows. And it could be that another business locally, a shop, comes up for sale. Right? You buy that shop, you turn it into a delicatessen, a takeaway, a cafe, and it stocks your products, and it stocks other products, and it becomes part of the community because it engages with the community, and therefore you're more important to the community. And therefore the community being important to you, when you get your employees out of that community, they're going to stay with you because they're part of the community. I'll leave it at that. Final word, experience. I did mention earlier, don't plan too far ahead. And I'm going to quantify that. We can learn a lot from other people's experience, but the most important experience is our personal experience, which is tailored to our strengths, our weaknesses, and the quality of the people around us. So be prepared to learn from your experience. Be prepared to make mistakes, because if you're not making mistakes, it means you're not taking risks. And if you're not taking risks, you're not innovating. And it's the innovators that get noticed and stand out, get the limelight, get the attention, so that when you export your whiskey out into the outside world, wherever you are, people are going to know its name even when it arrives on the shelf. Because you've been building up all that experience over these years that's taken you to develop your product, and you put it out there, and at that point, you may start to make a profit. I'm Ralfy, thank you for watching. I hope you'll join me again for my next Ralfy review, which will be an Irish whiskey. Yes, an Irish whiskey, and a rather good one too. See you then.